Hi, we will discuss the last reviewer for our pre-finals. So for today's video, we will discuss all of the following laboratory procedures. So number one, platelet aggregometry, ECLT or the euglobulin clot lysis time, thrombo-Welko test, and lastly, the antiphospholipid antibodies. We will begin with platelet aggregometry, no, which measures the ability to initiate aggregation, platelet aggregation in vitro. Ibig sabihin ng in vitro, sa labas ng katawan ng tao. Okay? And the principle of the instrumentation being used for this parameter are as follows. Number one, light transmission or also known as Born aggregometry. And in recent instrumentation, ito na yung ginagamit kasi ito rin ang ginagamit for cell counts, the electrical impedance aggregometry. Your reagents for this procedure are collectively known as platelet aggregation agonists. Agonist, ibig sabihin, initiator or activators. Okay, so pare-parehas lang yan. Pero in medical term, no, agonist is the better or terminology to be used. So ito yung pwedeng gamitin, di ba? We have mnemonics RACE. RACE stands for your Ristocetin, ADP, Collagen, and Epinephrine. Epinephrine, in some books, mababasa nyo sila as adrenaline. So parehas lang yung dalawang yan. In other machines, pwede kang gumamit ng additional agonists such as your arachidonic acid, thrombin, and serotonin. So you have to consider a lot of factors that would affect the platelet aggregation results. So these are as follows. So una, mga medications, no? Tingnan natin kung gumagamit siya ng clopidogrel. Clopidogrel is a known inhibitor of your ADP pathway. Okay? ADP is one of the in vivo agonist of platelet aggregation. Okay? And na-inhibit niya yung platelet aggregation via inhibition of what receptor? Your P2Y12 receptor. Okay. Aspirin naman, kaya niya mag-inhibit ng platelet aggregation by the inhibition of what enzyme? Your cyclooxygenase, which is the key player for the conversion of your arachidonic acid to thromboxane A2. Another variable that would affect the results is a high fat diet. No? Cholesterol can interfere, no, lalo na sa mga light absorbance methods. Okay? So kailangan mag-fasting yung pasyente for about 10 to 12 hours. And then for the vacutainer being used, no, mas preferred natin si itong dalawang ito, citrate or if available heparin. So EDTA is the least preferable vacutainer tube kasi it can cause pseudothrombocytopenia. Okay? Kasi bakit bumababa yung levels of your platelets kapag gamit mo EDTA? Kasi it can cause your phenomenon called platelet satellitism. Okay, the most commonly used for platelet studies is still citrate. Pero in recent studies, no, lalo na yung mga association for hemostasis and coagulation laboratories, no, ang gusto nila is heparin. Kasi heparin can preserve your platelets up to 24 hours, no. Pwede mo siyang i-store in a room temperature for 24 hours. Then lastly, no, ano ang type of preparation na gagamitin natin for the study? Ang best is the platelet-rich plasma. Siyempre, platelets ang iyong aaralin. So, kailangan madami kang platelets dun sa specimen mo. And PRP is being prepared by, no, centrifugation at 20 degrees Celsius or room temperature for 10 minutes at 200 centrifugal force. Let's discuss the light transmission principle. So, itong principle na to, katulad niya yung spectrophotometry principle. So, paano natin ito ginagawa? So, we prepare PRP and we warm the specimen at 37 degrees Celsius para magaya natin yung temperature ng body and to activate the proteins for aggregation. Okay? And then, mag-a-add ka ng iyong agonist. Pag nagsa-start na dumami yung platelet aggregation, as the platelet aggregate, bumababa yung nagpa-pass through na ilaw. Okay? So, the light absorption will decrease. And as we all know, no, yung, based on sa spectrophotometry principle, inversely proportional si absorption sa transmission. As mas maraming platelet aggregation, mas kumukonti yung light na na-absorb, mas dumadami yung natatransmit na light. So, ganito ginagawa yung graph based on the light principle. Dito sa ating y-axis, no, dito yung light transmission and yung markings niya is 0 dito and then pababa ng 100. Okay? Dito naman, sa ating x-axis is the time, no? Gaano katagal mag-uumpisa yung ating platelet aggregation. Okay? So, halimbawa, no? Yan na. Kung dito, halimbawa, dito ang start ng ating pag-add ng agonist. Okay? So, magsa-start na magkaroon ng reaction, no? And kapag, yun nga, pag bumababa na yung ating yung slope, ibig sabihin, no, tumataas yung light transmission. Kasi nandito yung 0, nandito yung 100. So, again, no, pag tumataas yung transmission, ibig sabihin, mas dumadami din si platelet aggregation. Okay? Hanggang sa maubos lahat ng platelet na pwede mag-aggregate. Okay? Okay. In impedance in principle naman, it can sense if there is an activity of the platelets. Mas maraming activity, no, mas malaking electrical resistance yung kaya niyang i-produce. Okay? So, kapag, no, kapag nag-add na ng agonist, magsa-start na yung differences between the electrical resistance. No? The more agglutination, the more resistance ang resulta. Okay, halimbawa dito, x-axis is the time, no, para mag-create ng agglutination. And then, yung y-axis mo is the amount, no, or the amount of the activity ng platelet aggregation. So, madalas ganito naman ang graph pag impedance principle ang gamit. So, tandaan nyo, no, yung ating light absorbance, no, pababa, yung impedance is pataas yung kanyang curve. So, meron tayong events na tinatawag natin classic biphasic aggregation. So, paano ito nangyayari? So, in this phenomenon, we have two waves. No? The first wave is what you call the primary wave, in which yung inyong aggregation is due to the exogenous reagent. Dahil yun sa reagent na inad mo. Okay? Yung second wave, no? And then makikita nyo medyo magpa-flatten ng konti and then tataas ulit. Yung secondary wave na to is due to the endogenous agonist naman na nasa loob ng specimen. Okay? Pwede itong mangyari, lalo na if ever yung reagent mo is collagen, ADP, yung mga yan, pwede makita yung agwat ng wave na to. So, let's proceed now with the expected results for each disorders. Okay? Kapag ganito yung itsura, halimbawa itong blue is the normal control. No? And a normal patient, ito yung ating in-expect na results. in a patient with von Willebrand or Bernard-Soulier syndrome, ang titingnan mo na abnormal result is dun sa restocytin. Sa restocytin, halos walang agglutination na nangyari. In disorders such as Gansman, thrombasthenia, and afibrinogenemia, okay, all of the following reagents hindi masyadong nagproduce ng agglutination except with restocytin. No? Restocytin is actually an exogenous type of agonist. Kaya medyo may makikita kang primary wave na makikita na activity. Okay? Next disorder is platelet storage pool disorder, no, in which all of the halos agonist sa pasyente ay missing, no. So makikita niyo diyan, no, meron tayong mga first wave or primary wave sa ADP. Adrenaline is also your epinephrine, ha, and collagen. In restocytin, partial lang, no, yung activity. Okay, mas know na table natin to, yung mga naka-red, yung inang kailangan natin maalala kasi yung distinctive na results in each of the variables. So, in a normal patient, no, lahat magkakaroon na agglutination except when you use a low levels of restocytin. Sa Glanzmann, thrombasthenia, and afibrinogenemia, no? Wala lahat yung kanyang results, no, except kapag high levels of restocytin ang gagamitin mo. Okay? In Bernard-Soulier syndrome and von Willebrand disorder, no, lahat meron naman, no, except for the restocytin. Wala siyang reaction for restocytin. In storage pool disorders, halos lahat may primary waves and partial agglutination, okay? Except for the low restocytin levels. In aspirin naman, ang wala is arachidonic acid. Isipin nyo, no? Cyclooxygenase is involved in arachidonic acid pathway, di ba? To convert it into thromboxane A2. So, mag-react siya dyan and also with low levels of restocytin. In clopidogrel, again, no, it will react to P2Y12 receptor found in the ADP-induced agglutination. So, kung affected niya yung ADP-induced, syempre dito yung in-expect mong walang agglutination. Okay, answeran natin yung ating activity sa inyong handouts. Handouts, I mean worksheet, okay? So, letter A. So, tingnan natin, no? Normal result daw ito. Tingnan natin. Meron. Wala, no? Sa restocytin. Meron din sa restocytin when in high doses. So, this is a classic picture of a normal patient. Okay? So, next naman. Okay? Meron tayong primary waves na makikita, no? And a agglutination then with high levels of restocytin. So, ano kaya yan? Okay, dito naman, meron positive, negative in arachidonic acid, negative in low doses of restocytin, meron sa restocytin. So, again, ano yung pinatanda ko sa inyo na negative, magda-negative lang sa arachidonic acid, si aspirin. Next naman is absent agglutination in ADP, collagen, epinephrine, arachidonic acid, restocytin, and a partial agglutination with high doses of restocytin. So, saan yan makikita? Sa Glanzmann, thrombasthenia, or what you call your absence of fibrinogen called afibrinogenemia. Okay, next naman, no? Meron, and then wala at all sa restocytin. So, saan yan? Sa Bernard-Soulier syndrome, and von Willebrand syndrome. Okay, so mas know natin itong tables na to. Next test is the ECLT or euglobulin clot lysis time. So, anong ibig bang sabihin ng euglobulin? This is actually a member of your plasma proteins, no? Kasama yan ng mga hemoglobins, no? And this part of your plasma can precipitate at low pH and decrease ionic strength, okay? So, madali siyang dapat mag-precipitate in acidic environment. And that precipitate, no, maghihiwalay yung mga proteins natin involved in coagulation process. So, ano yung mga maghihiwalay dyan? Ang precipitate mo will contain your plasminogen, tissue plasminogen activator or your TPA, and fibrinogen. Yung mga hindi naman magpre-precipitate are almost always your inhibitors of your fibrinolysis such as your alpha-2 antiplasmin and alpha-2 macroglobulin. Euglobulin clot lysis time or ECLT is being used as a screening test lang for fibrinolysis problems. Screening test, no, ibig sabihin kapag may suspecha ka ng fibrinolysis problem sa pasyente at kung positive siya dito sa test na to, tumataas ngayon yung chance na tama yung hunch mo. Okay? Hindi niya kayang i-confirm yung fibrinolytic problem. Ang mga confirmatory actually sa mga fibrinolytic problem is your assay, no. I-direct mo yung assay to determine the levels of your protein such as yung ano yung level ng PAI-1, ano yung level ng plasminogen, which is mas mahal, no, kung i-request natin. Okay, sa mga kapag nag-request tayo ng ECLT, ang gagamitin natin na anticoagulant sa pasyente is trisodium citrate. And then, i-freeze natin yan usually. Kapag after freezing the blood sample, in-add natin yung acetic acid. And may theory that acetic acid plus your blood will form the euglobulin byproduct. The euglobulin is actually contains your plasminogen, your TPA. No, lahat ng fibrinolytic proteins meron dito sa euglobulin. And then, you will try, di ba naka-anticoagulant nga, you will try to form the clot by adding thrombin dun sa blood sample. So, you will form a clot. Now, the principle is that the euglobulin must lyse your clot na na-form mo after the thrombin reagent. Okay? So, yun yung principle of the test. So, another principle is that meron lang certain amount of clot na kaya lang i-degrade ng euglobulin mo. So, merong half of the clot form will be lysed, half of the clot form will not be lysed. So, may certain level lang ng clots yung pwede niyang i-degrade or lusawin. So, dito i-refer natin dito sa picture na to, no? Tube 1, tube 2, and tube 3. Tube 3 is actually the control, no? Ganito siya ka-turbid. Pero, hindi masyadong turbid dahil only half of the clot is being lysed. Okay, kapag may madaming masyado ang fibrinolytic proteins ang pasyente, no? Madaming euglobulin na na-produce, ibig sabihin, lahat ng clot na na-form ng thrombin
kaya niyang lusawin. So, dito tayo sa tube 1. So, very clear na lahat na ng clot formation na degrade na or nalusaw. So, dito, we can deduce that there is an overfibrinolysis process and mabilis yung lysis time, no? There's a shortened lysis time or shortened ECLT result. Kapag naman walang masyadong uglobulin na na-produce yung pasyente, hindi niya malalyze yung mga clot form after the thrombin addition, no? So, kung papansin mo yung tube 2 and tube 3, mas turbid si tube 2, no, kung i-compare mo. Kung too much precipitate ang napapansin mo sa tube, we can assume that there is an underfibrinolysis process and prolong yung ECLT time. So, this test is very subjective, no? Nasa depende lang dun sa nag-o-observe na medtech. Kaya hindi siya masyadong ginagawa sa laboratory kasi there is a lot of mistakes, no, regarding dito sa mga comparison nito.
So, since, no, a screening test lang yung ECLT and na-consider siya as an obsolete method na dahil sa sobrang daming interfering factors kasi, no? Ang preferred lang gamitin sa ngayon ay yung TEG or ROTEM methodology, no? This is considered as your global hemostasis assessment. And ano nga ba yung mga sinasabi nga nating various factors that could affect your ECLT? So, ito yung mga yan, no? The factors that could increase your fibrinolysis is sa physiologic factors, normal diurnal variation. Ibig sabihin may mga proteins tayo na mas marami sa umaga kaysa sa hapon or kaysa sa gabi. Okay? And venous occlusion. Venous occlusion, mangyayari yan kapag prolong yung inyong tourniquet. No? Prolong tourniquet might cause an immature release of your fibrinolytic proteins. Kaya mag-increase yung iyong fibrinolysis. Okay? In physiologic factors naman that could cause your decreased fibrinolysis, again, no, the diurnal variation in the body, and at third trimester pregnancy, madalas kasi dito is thrombotic yung prone sa thrombosis yung mga pregnant women as in contrast, no, to bleeding disorders. Okay, pathologic ano naman factors that could lead increased fibrinolysis, no, factor 13 deficiency, again, no, kapag hindi masyadong stable ang fibrin mo, maybe due to the low levels of your fibrin stabilizing factors. And if ever ang pasyente mo ay meron siyang ongoing thrombolytic therapy such as your streptokinase. Pathologic disorders that could cause decreased fibrinolysis, DIC. DIC, no, disseminated intravascular coagulopathy, ubusin niya lahat ng proteins, right? Magagamit mo yan lahat. And kapag naman tag dito yung ating mga fibrins madaling ma-degrade, no, into FDPs. And lastly, your liver disease dahil siya ang sole producer of your proteins. Okay, next test is the thrombo-welco test, which is a screening test for the presence of your fibrinogen degradation products or FDPs. No? It is also considered a semi-quantitative test. No? Hindi lang siya presence or absence lang. It could say a certain amount kung ilan yung FDP present in the specimen. So, tingnan natin mamaya kung bakit siya semi-quantitative lang. So, the specimen is either serum no? Serum, ibig sabihin, hindi ka gagamit ng anticoagulants, no? Hindi mo preferred na citrated dapat yan, or EDTA, dapat serum lang, or a urine sample. So, the principle behind your thrombo-Welco test is the slide agglutination method wherein, no, you observe a agglutination phenomenon and it would be considered as a positive result. Ngayon, no, dahil semi-quantitative siya, so kailangan niya magsabi ng amount of your FDP. A positive result would mean that the presence of FDP would equal to or would indicate an equal to or more than 2 micrograms per ml of FDP. Okay, so tandaan yan, no? Okay, last na tayo. So, APL or antiphospholipid antibodies. So, the problem with these antibodies is medyo nakakalito siya, no? In vitro, no? Sa iyong mga test tubes, it could prolong the results. So, akala mo, bleeder yung pasyente, no? It could prolong your APTT, no? Basta lahat ng mga tests that would use an phospholipid as reagent, no? Dahil anti-phospholipid siya, kakalabanin niya yan. So, magkakaroon ka ng prolonged clotting time. So, akala mo, bleeder yung pasyente. But in reality, in vivo, sa loob ng katawan ng pasyente, antiphospholipid antibodies produces thrombosis. Okay? So, to answer one of the questions in your worksheet, no, what are the clinical criteria for diagnosis? So, first, kailangan malaman mo na meron siyang vascular thrombosis via, no, histopathology, no, under microscope, kailangan makita mo na may thrombosis sa either one or two organs. Okay? And then, next criteria is the pregnancy morbidity. Lalo na pag babae, syempre, no? And itong mga history na to, no, would create a suspicion na baka may apa siya. Okay? So, either one or more unexplained deaths at or beyond 10 weeks. Okay? Tapos, pag makikita mo naman ng baby, wala namang problema sa kanya. Buo yung, wala siyang problems with regards to its anatomy. Second, one or more premature birth. Okay? Buhay naman, no? Premature nga lang. Bakit nag-premature si mother? Dahil baka sa eclampsia or severe pre-eclampsia. And this condition is highly associated with APAS. And lastly, no, 3 or more unexplained abortions before 10th week of gestation, no? So iba to sa number 1, 1 or more unexplained deaths beyond 10 weeks. Ito naman, 3 or more unexplained deaths before 10 weeks. Ito naman, no, with consideration of, no, na exclude mo na lahat ng possible na cause of death. Okay? Hindi mo ma-exclude si APAS. So baka yun yung cause of abortion, no? Cause of the spontaneous abortion dun sa mother. So we have clinical criteria, we have laboratory criteria naman, no? Laboratory criteria is a patient should have at least 2 positive results for antiphospholipid antibody, and kailangan i-test mo yung dalawang resulta na to with the gap of 12 weeks. So dapat first test halimbawa in April, bilang ka ng 12 weeks, May, June, July. So dapat nandun sa nasa July yung next test niya. Okay, and we have 2 methods, direct method and indirect method. And direct method is you actually find a specific antibody. So ano yung mga specific antibody na hahanapin mo in direct method, no? You have cardiolipin and your beta 2 glycoprotein I, no? In recent studies and literature, may makita ka iba ng pangalan niya, apolipoprotein age na. No? Pakilagay na ng heart yan. No? Nice to know. And these two antibodies are being screened by your ELISA. Sa indirect method naman, we make use of your parallel assays. So, nakita nyo na to, no, yung mga parallel assays natin. So, konting updates lang, no? Meron tayong in-update dito na method. So, balikan natin to, no? Diluted Russell Viper Venom Test or DRVVT, which activates your factor 10. Silica clotting time. So, first time yung narinig, no? Discuss natin yan mamaya. Activates your 11A. Kaolin clotting time. Activates also your 12A. I mean, 12 pala, no? 12A. I'm sorry. And then, lastly, your diluted thromboplastin time activates your 7A. So, in parallel assays, hindi mo dapat ito gagawin yung apat ng sabay-sabay. Sabi nila, no, according to your ISTH or the International Society for Thrombosis and Hemostasis, I guess, at least 2 tests. And kapag dalawa lang ang gagawin mong test, piliin mo na si diluted Russell Viper Venom Test and your silica clotting time test. Okay, DRVVT. So, the venom or the reagent is being isolated or harvested from, no, a specific snake. No, the genus name is the boya, and the species name, no, either of these 3 spellings, no, up to debate pa rin kung ano dapat ang correct spelling. So, ito yung 3 pwedeng spelling natin sa ating answer. Basta the genus name of the Russell Viper is the boya. Okay, again, no, the specimen should be platelet poor plasma because kapag platelet rich, 'di ba, meron tayong mga phospholipids and calcium na pwedeng maka-disturb dun sa ating resulta. So kailangan malesen natin yung interfering substances. So kailangan platelet poor plasma and this specimen should have 10,000 platelets per cubic millimeter. No? How do we prepare this? So, we centrifuge it at 1,500 centrifugal force for 15 minutes. So, halimbawa, ito, no? RVV plus the phospholipid in our reagent, okay? And this would activate the factor 10 in your specimen. Halimbawa naman, kapag may sakit ng pasyente, RVV plus your phospholipid, no? Eh kung may antibody against phospholipids ang pasyente, tatanggalin niya yan. So, walang activation na mangyayari, prolong yung resulta mo. Okay. So, recent modification, no, di ba, in our previous discussion, simple partial thromboplastin time lang yung pwede natin gawin as one of the parallel assays. So ngayon, pwede ka nang gumamit ng modification, no? We make use as of silica, no? As a main reagent for this. So again, no, specimen natin is PPP. Okay? Silica plus phospholipid as reagent would activate your factor 12. And then si factor 12, no? Kapag hindi siya ma-activate kapag meron tayong anti-phospholipid antibodies directed to phospholipid reagents. Okay, that is my last slide, and the questions from this handout will be integrated with the pre-final examination. So we have 3 topics: disorders of fibrinolysis, instrumentation, and your pre-final practicals.